Welcome to First English. We're glad to have you here if you're a guest. If you've grabbed a connect sheet, we'll talk about that later in the service. But this morning we begin as our worship, as we always do, with confession and forgiveness. So I invite you to please stand for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all of our sins, who mercy endures forever. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Let us take a moment for our own personal confession this morning. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. Brothers and sisters, he forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister in the Church of Christ and by his authority, by God's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing it, Live Christ. For our God, our Father, and Lord Jesus, grace and peace be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. O God, judge eternal, you love justice and hate oppression, and you call us to share your zeal for truth. Give us courage to take our stand with our victims of bloodshed and greed, and following your servants and prophets, to look to the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. I invite forward all the children and youth of our congregation to come forward. Hey, today's an exciting day for me. Today, an exciting day for you. Today, first of all, it's the day that we get to kick off Sunday school. So Sunday school is a time here at the church where we take and you guys go out during the worship, and you get to go learn about this person as God that we talk about. And so you get to do different activities, and you get to meet different teachers. And do you know how long Sunday school's been around? Anyone want to guess? Get what? Forever, exactly. Forever, ever since when Jesus was walking with his disciples, as we hear in the gospel today, he says to his gospel, I got to teach you something. And he gives them a little bit of thinking. He says, you need to be obedient. What does that mean? Does anyone know what obedience means? Kyson. You got to listen, huh? There's not really a choice, is there? We talk about obedience is that we don't really use that too much when we're trying to like be on good behavior, but obedience is sort of what teachers want us to do when we sit in our classrooms, right? They want us to be to obey their rules. So that's what it means, obedience. I was also in Sunday school, and so just like the disciples and just like you, I, a long time ago, this is one of my Sunday schools. When you get older, you go to confirmation. So this is a picture of me. Can you find me in that picture? I'm the good-looking guy right in the middle. Can you see me? Does that look like me? Yeah, does that look like me today? Anybody else really want to see it? No, you've seen it, Eddie. Pass him over there, because I'm a good-looking guy. You all need to see what I looked like when I was in high school, middle school. So that was my confirmation picture. Kyson, can you count how many kids are in that class? Real quick. There was 8 kids. Yes, you want to see it? I'll bring it back. So listen, okay, bring it back so I can get your attention back. You can look later. Bad idea. Okay, so there was 8 kids in that class. And here's the cool thing. Almost all 8 of them I've either talked to or I see still. And I share that with you guys because today is the start of Sunday school, and you might be sitting next to someone in your Sunday school class that will become your friend forever. Maybe you won't live by each other, but you'll have that bond, and that bond is that you both be brothers and sisters in Christ, and you both learn about God's love together, and there's something special about that that goes beyond any other friendship that you'll ever imagine. So I want you to take Sunday school a little bit serious, and know that when you go this morning, that the teachers have prepared for you to be here, and they're really excited about it. So make sure you're obedient to what they're saying and not playing around with the other Gavin and paying attention. All right, let us pray. Say, hello, God. Thank you for loving us. Help us to be obedient in our Sunday school classes and also in our normal classes. We love you, God. Amen. Yeah. gospel. It comes from the gospel, Luke, the 12th chapter. I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think that I've come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. For now on five in one house will be divided. 3 against 2 and 2 against 3, they will be divided. Father against son, son against father. Mother against daughter, and daughter against mother. Mother-in-law against her mother-in-law, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. He also said to the crowd, When you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, it's going to rain, and so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be scorching heat, and it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. I should have probably read where these words were coming from, but I wanted you to hear them fresh and raw this morning, because they are harsh words. I came to bring fire to the earth, Jesus said, and how I wish I had already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed, Jesus said. You think I've come to bring peace to the earth? Jesus said, no. I tell you, but rather division. Just doesn't fit into the gospel. It just doesn't fit into the Jesus that we know, does it? The Jesus that we sing on Christmas Eve when we all come together, or we come and sing on Easter, that we talk about a God who brings together. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Peace is what we think that Jesus is about. Peace is what we sort of correlate with him and his actions. And here he is saying, no, I tell you, but rather division. And then goes on to talk about the separation of a household and how it will be divided. Father against son, son against father, those crucial relationships, the daughter and mother, and the mother and daughter, and the in-laws against the in-laws. That division is not something that we expect our Jesus, our God, to even talk about, and why in the world would we talk about it on a Sunday morning? But we need to understand where this fits in the gospel. You would have had the other bulletin. It says right there, this is, you have to image Jesus walking from all of his miracles he just did, all of the things he just did with his friends and his disciples and the people that have gathered with him. And he's walking his way to Jerusalem. He's heading to Jerusalem. He's heading to the cross. He's heading to Good Friday, and he's walking with his friends, his disciples. We call them disciples, his people, and he stops. And there's many commentaries say a gathered people joined and were around him, and he said to all of them, I didn't come to bring peace on the earth. I tell you, but rather division. Why? Because he's talking about obedience. He's telling his disciples that you've walked with me, you've seen me do all this stuff, you've seen me heal the blind, you've seen me show sight to the blind, heal the lame, make people walk, you've seen me do all these miracles, but guess what? It's getting real now. I'm going to the cross. I'm going to die. He says, you can predict the weather. You can predict the stuff like this, but I need you to understand something real is happening here. And I need obedience. Obedience to the point to where your household may divide. For us today, that's kind of crazy to think about. Divide over your faith. In seminary, I had a friend who was from Utah, who came and he was not really coming to seminary to be a pastor. He was coming to really figure out how he could be more of a follower of Jesus.
And he was sharing in class one day, he was telling about how he had five brothers back in Utah, and all five of them went a different way in their faith. He was still trying to figure out who God was. One was an atheist. One was really didn't really care to church. One was a Catholic, and one was a Mormon. He said, we'd get together, and we had to stop doing it, because every time we would get together, all we would do is argue who was right, who was wrong. We'd argue about the core of our faith. My friend said, I couldn't help it because I was trying to be obedient to God and Him calling me. I couldn't not say certain things. He shared as he continued on in his faith and growing in his faith, he started looking at people differently. He started looking at people differently and treating people differently. He shared before he was a follower of Christ and obedient to Christ, he saw situations and his heart was hardened. And as he became obedient to Christ, things changed. Maybe you don't have that exact situation in your life, but you probably can relate with it a little bit. Maybe not with your family, but maybe with friends. For my own personal thing, I remember when I kept telling people I'm going into seminary, some people said, really? You? Are you sure? And I had to change some things about my life. Maybe you too have that same experience. Yes, Jesus talks to his disciples about that because at that time, families were in tribal religions, and they were in the Jewish faith. They were committed to that. That was what you did. There was no questions about it. Today, we have a choice still. But God still asks us to be obedient. To be obedient to the point to where, yes, it will cause division. To be obedient because it will cause us sometimes to look differently at people and deal with situations differently and look at how the world wants us to look at it, but then knowing that we are who we are and we are followers of a God who is love and care, so we have to treat people differently because of that. So it can cause division. Maybe not in your family, but in your own heart. Maybe in your own friendship circle. And so this gospel text is kind of this odd gospel text right in the middle of it, and we can dwell on that division, or we can dwell on what God's really asking of you and me this morning. And don't get me wrong here, it's not the obedience to where if you don't have this obedience, salvation is taken away. We have to look at it from why we are obedient to a God who is so great. As I reflected this week, the three things that I came up with and the understanding of why I would want to be obedient to a God, I think can help us here. The first is because I know I'm forgiven. And since I know I'm forgiven, you're forgiven as well. Because I know that I'm broken, that you can be fixed, then I can be fixed, and we can be fixed together. See, that forgiveness is coming to you with no ifs, ands, or buts. That forgiveness that I proclaimed at the beginning of the service as a called and ordained minister in the Church of Christ, and by His authority, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins, of all of them. There's freedom from that. Because I know that some of us hold it deep inside and we don't believe that we can be forgiven, but you are. There's power in that. There's power that someone can say, you're forgiven. There's power in someone that says, it's okay. So when I figured it out, or when you figured it out, and when you really get your heart to understand that forgiveness is real, then it begins to refine you. And this could happen over the years, over the months, over the decades sometimes, but it refines on how we look at things. And I can tell you that 20 years ago, I was looking at something differently than I look at today. I look at things differently than I looked at a year ago. Because this gospel, this message of forgiveness continues to refine us. And sometimes maybe we're like glass and it's very smooth and it goes into the fire and it just twisting it. And next thing you come out, it's just this beautiful, wonderful piece of glasswork. Or maybe sometimes you go in the fire and it just melts right into the fire and you lose everything. Or maybe you're like metal. And you go into that fire and the flame is there and it heats up. And it comes out and it's still metal. You're still this blob of metal. And then the guy comes along and beats you with a hammer. Because you're so stubborn. You're so hard-headed. You're so set in your ways that you can't allow the words of forgiveness to change you. You might know someone like that. You might be someone like that. But it's that sense of freedom. It's that sense of forgiveness that, and then that refining that comes along that changes who we are. And then we become obedient. Not out of obedience because we're afraid, but because out of obedience because of what God has done for us. It says in our other readings that he's placed these great clouds of witnesses, that he's placed these other people in our lives so that we can continue to be reminded of why we are obedient, such an amazing God. But I want to go back to where we started. Obedience will change you. Obedience will cause division. Obedience will change your outlook on life. Obedience can be scary. Obedience can be scary because if you don't stay with what's the focus of it is following God and not about being right, not about being wrong. It's about the core values of it. And the core values is love. God asks us to be obedient to that. So that's where our text takes us. All over to this division, all over to these things of being aware, but also to being obedient. But I don't want you to leave here thinking that it's easy. That it's easy and it's something that we just wake up and every day just say, oh, I'm going to do this. Martin Luther, in many of his writings, said we should wake up every morning, mark our head with a sign of the cross, remind us of our baptism. Remind us that God receives us as broken people. So obedience to God will change you. But are you willing to take that chance? Are you willing to take that chance? Amen. The peace of the Christ be with you always. Mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to the help of all in need, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right in our duty and all in our time to give thanks and praise to Lord Jesus Christ. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given up for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup.
He blessed it and gave thanks and gave for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me. When we come together as the followers of Christ and to be obedient to Christ, we pray the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, in this sacrament, God renews, restores, and reconciles us as the body of Christ, and sends us out in the power of the Holy Spirit to proclaim the good news of the risen Christ. Amen. The Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. Christ, we leave with that power of Christ, and hopefully God filled you, and I know God filled you with his gospel this morning. We can leave the chair set up. Let us go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.